this morning. Always enjoy that. It's a busy week ahead for the church as we look at the week ahead. If you look at your insert in your program this morning, turn my light on so I can read. We have Hollybrook today at 3, and in advance we thank Sherry and Ben Ross, who are going to have some special gifts for all the attendees today when we have our service at 3, so we appreciate them coming with us and handing those out today. As we look ahead to this week, we have the Aces football team here Friday morning, bright and early at 7 a.m. for our annual pancake breakfast, and we appreciate all the folks who will be coming in early to take care of that and feed the football team and the cheerleaders and the coaches, and so we look forward to that as we always do each year. I don't know if you noticed this morning up on the announcements, I put one up and mentioned that the football team won last Friday evening in a real barn burner of a game, 23-20. And the Aces marching band was crowned grand champion yesterday. So congratulations to them. And finally, but not last, certainly not least, the Aces women's golf team claimed their third state title. So a big weekend for the Aces. Also coming up next weekend, we have several things at the church. We do have our stewardship luncheon next week, and everyone is invited to stay and join us for lunch. We also have right between our church service and that luncheon a very quick, hopefully, board meeting where we're going to talk a little bit about and hopefully come up with a solution for our furnace down in the education building that is no longer able to work. And so we've done some background work, and hopefully we'll solve that equation or come up with a solution next Sunday with a quick board meeting just to deal with that one topic. So are there other announcements this morning from the congregation? You have what coming up this? An anniversary. Well, good for you. How many years, Wilbur? 55 years. How about that? Wow. Good for you. That's a wonderful thing. All right. Any others? Gail? All right. Okay. How old is Emily? We're getting a consensus that she's 98 years old. Emily Ewald, her birthday is tomorrow, and she's been moved to Oakview. So she broke her hip, did she? Yes, and she's in rehab, and she's at Oakview now. So if you get a chance, certainly think about Emily, and if you get a chance, I know she'd love to see people or love to have a card. So other announcements this morning? If not, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. please stand and join me for our opening hymn, number 543, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my
God of hope, who brought love into this world, be the love that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought joy into this world, be the joy that dwells between us. And Lord, let you be the center of our lives, the focus of our lives. And in being so, let us recite the words that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Jet, would you help the young people come to the front for our young disciples moment? Okay, thank you. Good morning. Did you guys have a good week? How was Children's Christian Fellowship this past week? Was it good? It's awesome, wasn't it? You weren't there? Oh, you had to go to the doctor. I'm sorry. Is everything okay? Oh, my goodness. That's no fun. You got McDonald's. Okay, very good. Wow. Gracie, what sport are you playing this fall?
Basketball.
Okay. Everything going good? Leading the team in scoring? What's that? No? Rebounding? Okay. Your dad behaving? I wish Evan could span the camera over towards Barry with hair, Harry Barry, but he can't because he's got new glasses. They look good. All right, you guys. Today the message is about commitment, okay? And what I want you to think about, how do you know that Jesus is committed to you? So he came and lived, was born among sinners and lived among sinners and then died for us sinners. That's very good. Thank you so much, Louise, for that. Anybody else have a thought about it? How do you know that Jesus is committed to you? How many of you like hugs? Oh, yeah. Yeah, we all like to be hugged, especially when we've been hurt, right? Or we feel lonely, it's good to have a hug, right? And did you ever notice the cross? The cross up there. Jesus was hung on the cross for our sins, okay? And his arms, was his arms on the cross? Can you stand up and show us? That's right. Now, does that kind of look like someone getting ready to hug somebody? Right? And Jesus hung on the cross as a sign of love. And I was thinking about that this morning. Is the hugs and commitment. When someone hugs you, do you feel like they love you and they're committed to you and they're going to help you? What do you think, Jet? What do you think, Keegan? A hug means you're loved, that you're a friend, right? Well, when Jesus was on the cross, and it's like he's ready to hug us, okay? And love us, and forgive us. And he's no longer on the cross. He's with us right now. He's present here. And he gives us his love. And in a sense, he hugs us and comforts us in our most difficult times. Just think about that for a little bit. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you so much thanks for the commitment you have for us, and it's based on love. It's based on presence. It's based on forgiveness. Oh God, I ask that you be with our young people and that they know your love, and as they are taught every Wednesday, that they find ways to share your love. Amen.
Those who need our thoughts and prayers are Fred and June Zonders, Emily Ewald as she continues her rehabilitation, Dana Tate and her family, Kim Manier, Anthony Escobedo, Misty Fisher. Any updates on Misty? Misty is doing better. And then among friends of the congregation, Bob Brewer and Caitlin Brown. Please remember Caitlin Brown in your prayers as well this week. And also our thoughts go out to what's taking place in Israel and the Gaza Strip. We ask that God brings comfort to those who are suffering. And we place these concerns before Christ. Let us continue our worship. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to you in this place of worship, committed to you. Each of us brings different gifts and talents to your ministries in this challenging world. And as our lives on earth are rich with your blessings, they are also difficult. Please remind us to come to you in all that we do. Remind us that you are with us, present with us every step of the way. Give us insight now how our actions, responses to your world, and the work we do, consciously or not, reflect you. Help us to seek ways to be living testimonies of your love. Show us how to walk humbly and work through us to heal the parts of the world that are so sinful and broken and evil. Where there is evil, where there is sickness, anxiety, or loneliness, please step in and provide your grace and love. For those who are needed to help with physical care, with emotional support, and are burdened by the complexity of supporting those in need, we ask for your uplifting arms of love to embrace them. And now we take a moment in silent prayer to remember those in our communities and the world who need you. Hear us, O God. Our hearts go out to what's happening in Israel. It's hard to believe that Jerusalem means foundation of shalom when it's never been a true place of peace. We pray for those that have lost their lives there. Also for those who need hope. We pray for our government. Please guide, guard, and direct our leaders in each and every step they take. Remind them that they are to be just and merciful servants and stewards of your world. May they be peacemakers. Help us to do your work, O God, in this place as we begin this time of stewardship, commitment, discernment. We ask that you move us to find ways that we might be able to support in our time, treasures, and talents in our ministry together. Remind us that each of us are important to the ministry you have entrusted to us. And create within each of us a quiet, holy space to reflect on the role you would have for us. And allow us to prayerfully consider the gifts we will return to you next Sunday. Oh God, we love you. May we be faithful. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
As we enter our time of stewardship this morning, remember that the wealth or abundance of our lives is a gift, not just a given. That is, no more than with life itself do we have this as something we can earn or deserve. It's not an entitlement, but a blessing in which others are meant to share. With those thoughts in mind, let us receive our morning offering. Father, as the chilly mornings and cooler days of fall surround us, let us be mindful of the countless blessings you have bestowed upon us. Your grace and mercy truly fills our days. May our gifts, our tithes, our offerings help others in need, and may our actions lift others up as you have done in our lives. Amen.
let's talk about Jesus. The King of Kings is He.
The Lord of Lords.
The Lord's a
throughout eternity.
The great I am, the way, the truth, the life, the door. Let's talk about Jesus more and more.
Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Hails to every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Let's talk about Jesus more and
today's scripture lesson is found in the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 1 through 8 and 16 to 18. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons. Moab is in southern Judah. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephraites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there, but Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died. And she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. Then she started to return with her daughters-in-law from the country of Moab, for she heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had considered his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where they had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts me from you." When Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. come together to hear the story. And it's a story that would make Danielle Steele blush. It has dead ends and it has new beginnings. It deals with grief and explores commitment. It's a story of Ruth. It takes place during the period of the judges. And back in the day of the judges, when chaos ruled the world, and it seems it still does, a famine in the land of Bethlehem caused a man by the name of Eli Molech. Eli, God. Molech, Lord. The Lord my God. Interesting name. A man of faith. And his wife Naomi, along with their two sons, to migrate to Moab in hopes of finding food. Somebody told them to cheer up. Things could get worse. So they cheered up, and sure enough, things got worse for them when they decided to go to the new land. It was there that Eli Molech died. Then the two sons married to two Moabite women. Against their religious heritage, they were non-Jews, these Moabites. One named Orpah, I want to say Oprah so bad, Orpah, and another named Ruth. 10 years later, both died. And they found, as we find, that life is always full of crossroads and worse detours. Hearts are broken, hearts that were just as sensitive as yours and mine. What does one do with the detours of life? It's not a question of whether or not you will have a detour. It's what you do with those detours that happen in your life. Carrie Underwood, I guess I'm getting older, I'm using these older songs, had a song that hits the nail on the head. Ray, you want to take a guess? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The song says that she was on her way to Cincinnati to see her mom and daddy on a cold, dark winter night. She was driving too fast when the wheels started sliding with the baby in the back. That's when this mother began to pray. Jesus, take the wheel. Take it from my hands, because I can't do this on my own. I'm letting go. So give me one more chance to save me from this road I'm on. Oh, Jesus, take the wheel. That's a wonderful prayer, isn't it? When life is confusing, when it's full of anxiety, when you're traveling a road that you have no idea where it's going to end, Jesus, take the wheel. Well, Naomi decides to return to Bethlehem, to her people. Things are better there. The rains have come, and the famine has finally ended. So Naomi bids her daughters-in-law goodbye. Orpah kisses Naomi goodbye, and she returns to her family. But Ruth will have nothing to do with that. In verse 17, we get the verse that everybody knows, which we read this morning from the book of Ruth, about commitment. Oh, King James, I like the way it reads. It reads, "Entreat me not to leave thee or return from following thee, for whither thou goest, I will go. Whither thou lodgest, I will lodge. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. And where you are buried, there I will be buried as well." Think about that. That was spoken by a daughter-in-law to her mother-in-law. It's a radical statement of loyalty and commitment. Ruth commits herself to Naomi, to a new religion, to a new life, to a radical, different way of living. Gentile in a Hebrew land. You are most likely to hear these words sung at a wedding. While the context has nothing to do with a wedding, it has everything to do with ultimate commitment. We like that stuff of commitment, even though it frightens us. Commitment is a land of certainty in a sea of change. Commitment is a promise of presence in a world that is unpredictable and in constant change. Commitment is a chance that we take, a vow that we make, because humans are not made to be like butterflies or hummingbirds, fluttering here and there in search of the sweetest nectar. The world can only function on commitment. Those words, "Wherever you go, I will go." My friends, we live in an age where we need that kind of promise today, don't we? That promise in families, in churches, among friends, and among countries. Oh yeah, life is full of decisions. And caring people don't throw relationships away just because they struggle from time to time. We need to hang in there. Next Sunday, we have our Stewardship Sunday. And that's where we think about our commitment and how we will work together for the cause of Christ. The cause of Christ that happens through us when we are faithful. But also we need to think about our commitment to one another and to those who've gone on before us in the past, because we share this ministry. Hang in there. Something that's interesting, the word redemption in this short little book appears 23 times. 23 times redemption occurs. Redemption. It's not a word we use much anymore, is it? I remember when I was a little boy, I'd go to my great-grandmother's house, and she had those S&H green stamp. Remember those? And they had that little catalog where you go to A&P and you go in A&P and they'd have like a bicycle or something sitting in the front for those S&H green stamps. Well, you take those stamps and you redeem them for a prize. Some of us redeem frequent flyer miles for more trips or hotel stays. To redeem something then means to buy it back, cash it in, set it free. I want to tell you something about this story, because this is what makes it really neat, is that there's something else going on underneath the surface in this story. So Ruth goes to glean grain in the fields of Boaz. Such practice was an ancient form of welfare. Whatever grain was missed in the harvest, the poor were able to go in there and gather the grain to make bread. Boaz likes what he sees. And then there's a night on the threshing floor. There are some property rights to be dealt with. But eventually, Boaz takes Ruth to be his beloved wife. And together they have a son, whom they name Obed. Obed is the grandfather of King David, whose lineage Christ himself is born. Wow. Jesus has a Gentile in his lineage. Think about that. No matter what's happened in your life, no matter the circumstances, no matter the grief, no matter the change, there is one who comes to buy it back, to redeem, to set us free. And we believe that person is Jesus the Christ. Once upon a time, there was a preacher up in Boston in the early part of the 20th century. On one Sunday, the preacher carried an old, beat up, rusty, smelly, feather-laden cage into the pulpit with him, and he told a story. He said, "I guess you guys are wanting to know what I'm doing with this bird cage. Let me tell you where I got it. I bought it from a boy on the street, and he had birds in it. I asked him what he was going to do with those birds, and he said, well, I'm going to play with them. I'm going to tease them. I'm going to poke them and irritate them. And then I'm going to take them home and feed them to my cat." The old preacher said, "Well, how much do you want for those birds?" The boy said, "Ah, you don't want these nasty birds. These birds, all they do is eat, sleep, and poop. They're worthless. They don't sing or anything. They just hang in this cage." Nevertheless, he hung in there with the boy until he convinced the boy to take some money for the birds. And then the preacher took those birds and set them free in the park. The old preacher leaned over the pulpit and said this: "God saw Satan playing around with his people. God had made in his own image. God said to Satan, 'What are you going to do with my people?' And Satan replied, 'Well, I'm going to tease them a little while, make them marry and divorce. I'm going to make them hate and fight and kill each other in the streets. I'm going to have them throw bombs and shoot missiles and hate one another to death. And guess what? Then I'm going to gather them up, condemn them, take them with me to the gates of hell, because they are worthless anyway.' And God said, 'How much do you want for them?' I'll tell you what, I'll take your son for these worthless people." And on that day, God so loved the world that he sent his only son to set us free. New life is costly, and you're worth it. There's detours in life, and they can be deadly, so we let Jesus take the wheel. And what does God ask in response? Commitment. Commitment. Please stand and reaffirm your commitment to Christ in the singing of our hymn of commitment. How much does God love you? This much. This much. Let us remember and give thanks.
Let us pray. When we fall, faithful God, you catch and lift us up once again. When our spirits are low, your spirit gives us encouragement. When we hunger for your presence, you hear our cries and fill our needs. We are thankful that you care. We break this bread and raise this cup today, recalling our Savior's last earthly meal, and remembering the supreme love expressed therein. We share the bread and drink this cup as one. Help us to live, work, and witness as one, bound together in love by your Spirit. Amen.
Let us remember our Lord and Savior took the loaf, he blessed it, and he gave it to us, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." And he took the Passover cup of blessing, and he said these words, "This cup is now the new covenant in my blood shed for the sins of the world. Take and drink." Oh God, we give you thanks for this time where we can come and sit before you, and you hug us with your Spirit, and you remind us of your love. May we be faithful, as the only response to that now is to share that love. Because we've been graced, we must be gracious. Amen. Keegan and Luis, what does Stacy say to someone who misbehaves during Children's Christian Fellowship? Oh, can you say that again?
Now, is that not sharing God's love?
We are to share God's love now as we go into the world. Amen.